Bye. battle. You see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain now. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I'm safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle. And nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. And nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows.
Just in an act of worship, lift up your hands. Let's sing that out again. So when I fight,
I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Jesus, we thank you that you are a good shepherd, that you care about your flock, you care about us. so we don't have to wonder about your intentions. But we can know and trust that you are right there with us, caring for us, leading us. So may our faith and our trust in you not be swayed. May our love for you not be swayed by circumstances. May our worship for you not be swayed by circumstances.
Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails. He won't fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God is never late. He's working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Count on one thing,
I count on one thing. The same God who never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise. Glorify, glorify the name of all things. Nothing can stand against. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Oh, my day. Oh, yes, I will.
That's the desire of our hearts, God, to keep saying yes, to keep praising you. When life is hard and we go through valleys, to keep choosing to follow Jesus, living by faith. And God, I pray now that as we open your word, that you would continue to speak to us. Speak to us through your word, through your spirit. Spiritually form us and make us into the image and likeness of Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I want to invite you to follow along on the screen and on the app in your Bibles. So, as I said earlier, we're going to slow down a little bit. Rather than introducing a new text, we're going to wrap up, do a series recap, and we want to sort of set the table for communion and some sharing time. So we've been in this series called Freaking Out, and why we don't need to. The big idea for the series has been that we have a king who has a kingdom. His Jesus is our king, and he's ruling and reigning. He's ruling and reigning in his kingdom, and he's invited us to rule and to reign with him. And so when we go through valleys, we have these freak out moments. We don't have to be afraid because we have a savior. We have a redeemer. We have a king. If you study scripture, like there's all kinds of stories. There's all these freak out moments in the Bible of people that went through valleys and had moments where their faith was shaken and how God met them in that space. We launched this series by looking at Saul and the Damascus Road experience. A message titled Stop Kicking, Acts 9, 4 and 5. I just highlight a couple of verses for each of these as we recap the series. It says, he fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. I am Jesus whom you were persecuting, he replied. God is amazing. Saul had this freak out moment where he was on his way to this place to arrest Christians, take them back to Jerusalem, and Jesus met him on the Damascus Road. It was an encounter with the living God that would change Saul's life forever. It's amazing. God is still in the business of intercepting people's lives, not to hurt them, but to get them headed in the right direction. That's what he did with Saul. Saul would have this encounter with Jesus on the Damascus Road where he fell to the ground. He was blinded by this great light. Like God knew it would take some kind of a dramatic crisis to arrest him, to intercept his life and get him turned around. Saul would go on to become the Apostle Paul, church planter, missionary, apologist, evangelist, biblical author. Like what God did when Saul, who became Paul's life, was incredible. And what we concluded with that story in the Bible is that God is still specializing in doing those kinds of things. He's still in the process of intercepting people's lives and getting them headed in the right direction. God is, someone has characterized God as like a hound from heaven. Like he will pursue you. He will chase after you and intercept your life, not to hurt you, but to get you headed in the right direction, a divine direction for God's mission and God's glory. So we don't fight against God, but we surrender to God and flow with his plan for our lives. That is kicking, stop kicking. And then number two, the second message in this series, we said the title is Always Enough. Mark 6, 36 and 37. Send the people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat. But he, Jesus, answered, you give them something to eat. So this is the feeding of the 5,000, which likely would have been a bigger number with men, women, and children, although the text says there were 5,000 men. That's a big crowd. And they were having this freak out moment. The disciples are with Jesus. He is teaching the crowds, this mass of people, and it's getting late in the day. And the disciples who were helping to coordinate this ministry event say to Jesus, we're anticipating a problem. It's becoming late in the day. Why don't you dismiss the crowd? Like, send them away. Send them away so they have enough time to go and get something to eat. Because we don't have enough resources to feed all these people. We don't have this kind of food. And so their solution was to send them away. And it is so easy as followers of Jesus to see the problem. It's easier to see the problem than it is to see the possibilities. This was a test. And Jesus was testing his disciples. I mean, he knew what he was going to do. He knew that he was going to multiply the loaves and the fish to feed the multitudes, but they didn't know what he was going to do. This was a test for his disciples. How would they react? Their solution was, often I see myself in these kinds of stories, this is probably what I would have done, you know, send them away. You might send them over there so they can go get some food, because you look at what we have, and it's like, we don't have enough food or enough resources to feed this many people. They were like shushing them away. It's like, Jesus, this is over now. This whole teaching time, it's been great, but it's over now. Send them away. And Jesus, I mean, maybe Jesus wanted them to say, you know, we don't know how Jesus is going to, you know, fix this problem. But we do know that we have the Son of God in the flesh, Jesus Christ in person, fully God, fully man, standing right here in front of us. He is the miracle worker. He is the one that has turned water into wine. He has walked on water. He has brought back people from the dead. We have this man standing in front of us. Maybe Jesus was wanting them to say, we don't know how he's going to do it. We just know that he can do the impossible. And yet all they were focused on was what they didn't have. They could not see the possibilities. We believe that with God, all things are possible. Jesus turned to the disciples and says, no, don't send them away. You give them something. It was amazing. Little boy had a lunch, sack lunch, loaves and two fish. Jesus took it, broke it, blessed it, and then he fed the multitudes. Incredible. With God, all things are possible. We want to train ourselves to not only see the problems, but we also want to see the possibilities because we believe in, we have the miracle worker. It's incredible. That's the second message in the series. And then thirdly is find peace. So John 14:27, Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. So this is just one verse. There's a whole passage of verses in this particular text that we studied and dove into. This is one of the last things that Jesus said to his disciples, to his followers, before he would die on the cross for the sins of humanity. He says, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. And what he's doing is he's contrasting. There are two different kinds of peace. There's the peace that our world will offer us. And then there is the peace from heaven. The peace that is in a person, that's found in the person of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. And Jesus is contrasting these two different kinds of peace. Worldly peace and the shalom peace of God. It's the idea that we are designed to flourish, not in the absence of conflict or problems, but in the midst of them. Jesus says, I'm here to give you this kind of peace. Multiple times in this text, he says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't be afraid, because I'm here and I'm going to give you peace. The world will say, you can have peace, that peace is possible and peace is found in possessions. You know, just spend your life acquiring all of the toys and possessions. When you have enough stuff, that's where you will find peace. But we know that isn't true. The world will say you can find peace in the right place. Just get the right house, the right property, the right place. For years, confess something to you? For years, I've wanted to have an island in the Caribbean somewhere where just Kendra and I can live and nobody else can be there. Maybe our kids, for sure our grandkids would be with us. You ever like had that kind of a fantasy, just going somewhere where nobody could find us? Like, wouldn't that be awesome? Like an island somewhere that is just you and whoever. Because we tend to think, man, if I could just get that right place, then I would have peace. Then I'd be stress-free, no problems. And that's not what Jesus is saying. You can find the right place. You can have all of the possessions. That's not where you will find lasting, permanent, shalom kind of peace. We tend to think that peace is found in possessions and a place, or in power, position, prestige. Man, if I could just have the right amount of status where when people look at me and value me, I'm an influencer on social media, then I would have peace. Jesus says, oh, peace is not in possessions, it's not in position, it's not in finding the right place, it's not even having a life that is absent of problems. You know what he says in this verse? He says, peace is in the person of Jesus. Here's what he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Peace, the shalom peace of God, is in the person of Jesus Christ. He is our Prince of Peace, so that when you have Jesus, when he is your Lord and your leader, your Savior, your Redeemer, he's the one that is giving you this peace that surpasses understanding. Hello, church, I could preach on that all day long. Come on, somebody. And then another message was, rest assured, John 11. This is the story of Lazarus. So verses 6 and 7. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, let us go back to Judea. This verse has always sort of caused me to be a little unsettled about Jesus, what he did. So Jesus was close to Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And he got word that Lazarus was sick. And the text says that he waited 2 more days. It's almost like Jesus could be perceived as uncaring, a little slow to respond. He waited 2 more days knowing that his friend Lazarus was sick. And then he says, let us go back to Judea. They get there, and Martha meets Jesus at the door. And they've spent lots of time together. They're close. They're friends. She says to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Lazarus would still be alive. Like, you missed the window of opportunity. Like, she's frustrated. You can hear it in the language. She's frustrated with Jesus. Like, your timing is terrible. Like, you're late to this appointment. If you had been here, you know, you could have saved my brother's life. But then she went on to say, but even now, God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. It is like in my journey with Jesus, I've often felt like God is late. Have you ever felt that way? Like God, you're just, I mean, this would be an opportunity for you to show up on time, to do something big, to make your presence known. And have you ever felt that, where it's like, you just have this sense that God, it seems like sometimes you're late. We know that you're never late. We know that God is sovereign and he's perfect in his timing. But from a human perspective, sometimes it feels like, or it seems like God's timing is off, or like he's a little bit late. Here's the truth. Our delays are not always God's denials. While it might seem like God is late, or he's not on time, or like he's missing opportunity, he is never late. That we can trust his timing. And even on this side of eternity, we may not fully understand God's ways sometime in the future. Maybe in eternity, for sure in eternity, we will fully understand. God is always at work. God is sovereign. His timing may seem suspect, but we know his intentions are always good. You can trust his intentions. We can trust his timing. Our delays are not always God's denials. And then last week, we wrapped this up, the series, with Don't Worry, the text from Luke 12, verse 31 and 32. But seek his kingdom, Jesus said, and these things will be given to you as well. Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. I love the tenderness of Jesus here. He says, gives us a command, seek the kingdom. And then he says, don't be afraid, little flock, for your Father will give you the kingdom. He's saying, if you seek the kingdom, the Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. It's like God is not hiding himself. God wants to be known. He has invited us to seek the kingdom, to advance the kingdom agenda. And when we do that, it's like he is pleased to give us the keys to the kingdom. He's not withholding the kingdom from us. This whole text in Luke 12 is really about not worrying. This is so challenging for us. I've been preaching this text to myself this last week because Jesus said to his disciples, it's like, you don't have to worry. You can stop worrying because you have a heavenly Father who takes care of birds and flowers. Will he not much more take care of you? The people that should be worrying are the pagans, those that don't believe in God, that don't have a heavenly Father. They have a reason to worry, but you don't have a reason to worry because you have a heavenly Father that sees you and cares about you. And if he takes care of the like little things like birds and flowers, will he not much more take care of you? It's irrational to think that we can trust God with our eternity, but not trust him with Thursday. It's irrational. Last Thursday, thank you for your prayers. It's when I took Samuel and Corey to Phoenix, Arizona, to drop them at Aimright for a year to serve there with the inner city kids. I was preaching this text to myself all week. I have a heavenly Father that takes care of birds and flowers. Will he not much more take care of Samuel when he's out there on his own in this broken, dark world? You know, I kept preaching that. It's like, I can trust you. God, I want to trust you. Help me trust you. That's the takeaway for that message, this text, that we can trust God. I don't want to live like a practical atheist where I say I believe in God, but then I live like everything is on me. No, everything is on God. And I just want to keep trusting him with the things that are dear to me, the things that I tend to worry about. I want to offload them and let God carry them, that we can know God and we can trust God because that's who God is. God is caring. He sees you. He's macro and he's micro. He's big and transcendent, but he also cares about the little things, the details in your life. God is so amazing. And so we've made a commitment. Say, okay, God, I want my life to be characterized by trust. I can trust you with my eternity, and I can trust you with Thursday. We let go of worry, and we choose to trust God with everything. It's been such a good series. I know that a number of you have or are going through things that are maybe causing you to freak out a bit. But the Bible calls us back to faith, life of faith, a life of trusting in our Lord and our Savior, in our King, King Jesus. And I'm just so grateful for you. I see the struggle, and it's hard because you want to fix it. You want to like, God, please help. And God does. He doesn't often remove the struggle, but he leads us through it. His power, his provision, his faithfulness. And we want to, one of the things that we'd like to continue to do in our gatherings is to create space for you, for the Spirit of God to speak through the voice of the people. We're a priesthood of believers, and we want to be authentic. And today, really, is just about slowing down, just slowing down, doing a wrap-up for the series, giving an opportunity for you. You know, if God is speaking to you, if you have been going through something that could encourage the body, or if you want us to pray for you, you have a prayer request, we want to just invite you right now, just the courage to get up out of your seat, to come up here to the mic, and just share. As I've been talking, if the Spirit of God is prompting you or giving you a verse that could edify our church, just to have the courage. You know, we're all in this together. This is just informal. And so I'm going to pause just for a moment and provide just some space for you to speak, to share, if the Lord would lead you to do so. Just come up to the front right now. Is there anyone? We'll wait just for a few seconds, a few moments.
A couple weeks ago, I had a freak out moment. And it was hard because you realize who your friends are, who your true friends are, and who your enemies are. And through that moment, it landed me in a correctional facility. It was difficult. I went through a lot of hell. But one thing that got me through the other side was my mom's Bible. My mom's Bible. Sorry. I never had a psychiatrist in there. Apparently, the psychiatrist was on vacation for about 3 weeks. And so I took it upon myself to be that hope. Those people that were hurting in there. And yet I struggled because I thought I was the one that was having a rough time. But there's kids in there, there's older adults in there that were struggling with suicide, depression, anxiety, worry, fear. And every time I opened up my mom's Bible, I would have at least 5 or 6 people just surrounding me, asking me like, hey, can you read something to us, something that's encouraging? I got that every time. It was awesome. It was amazing. And this one kid, he was about 23, 24. He was agnostic. And he said he didn't believe in God. He believes in a higher power, but God was never there for him. So I opened up my Bible, pulled out a couple scriptures, and I came across one of my favorites, which was Ephesians 2:10. It says, you are God's masterpiece. And honestly, it shook him because he's never felt that with his family, his parents. His mom meant a lot to him, but he just said some things he shouldn't and it went south. And he's like, I blame myself for a lot of those things. But honestly, he said, I blame God because of what happened to me. And I said, dude, I said, it's not God. God is here for you. What's cool about this whole thing is, long story short, I led him to Christ. And honestly, my mom's Bible got passed around to so many people in that facility. Like, I always had somebody knocking on my door asking, hey man, can I just borrow your Bible? I just want to read something. I'm like, sure, anytime. I realized that I was not there by accident. Not only did it help me, it helped the people that were in my inner circle. And I am blessed to have had that experience, to experience that with those people. And I still have all their numbers, and I still check up on them, like, if not once a day, once a week, just to see how they're doing. But we need to realize that in our own freak out moments, there's other people hurting as well. one thing that has meant a lot to me is it's Proverbs 24, verse 16. And it says, though a righteous man may fall seven times, he still rises again, even though the unrighteous may fall. And it is hard to be standing when all around you things are just falling apart. I have had worries, I've had anxiety, but what has kept me going is Christ's love for me, his grace, his acceptance, his willingness to be first in my life. Even though, like Pastor Larry said, sometimes we don't trust God enough like we should. Yeah, trust God. Two words that is simple to say, but is so difficult to do sometimes. But I would encourage all of us to trust God, trust in his grace, rest in his love, and spread that love to others. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that word and for you the healing journey that you're on. Keep rising up, brother. Keep rising up. Thank you. Anybody else? Just come up to the front. Don't be afraid. We're all in this together. You have a word, encouragement, a verse, something. Wait just for a couple of seconds yet. Is there anyone? We're going to be taking communion together. We're going to sing a couple of songs. And as we continue to worship, just want us to prepare ourselves. The Bible says you come to the communion table to examine yourselves. As we worship in these moments of reflection and just slowing down, I just want to invite you to pray and you confess any sins that are unresolved and give your heart, your allegiance to King Jesus. Ask God to search your hearts as we prepare to participate in this sacred practice of remembering the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We participate in the life of Christ as we take communion together. And yeah, it's such a sacred time. If you would just pray with me, God, in these moments where we want to prepare ourselves for this act of remembering the atonement of Christ on the cross for the sins of humanity, that we could be reconciled, where your wrath could be appeased because of the blood and body of Jesus. Oh God, thank you for giving us your very best. Thank you for life, the opportunity to hear the good news and to respond. We commit these moments of worship and reflection to you in Jesus' name.
So good, with every breath that I am able. goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father.
Jesus, we thank you that we can trust you. May we look back and see your goodness on display over all of our lives so we can trust you for the future. I want to invite you all to stand and sing with us.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy. till that stone was built for good, for the Lamb who conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame, that this gospel
you to take communion today as we seek to remember and value and cherish the life of Jesus. These verses from 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 to 25. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." We take communion as an act of obedience to remember what Christ has done for us. Our lives, our spiritual lives, our lives, our identity rests in the finished work of the cross. Christ's life and death. But he didn't stay dead. He's alive. He's interceding for us. He's called us to follow him. So when we take communion, we're remembering, we're obeying, but we're also participating in his life. We're continuing to say yes to Jesus, yes to the new covenant, yes to grace. We don't pull ourselves up. We don't make this happen. We simply receive the gift. We live in the grace. I'm going to pray for us. As soon as I'm done praying, we're going to just pause, and as the Spirit would lead you, you can make your way to the front. We have three stations here at the front, two in the back. Whenever you're ready, just make your way to one of the serving stations. You take the bread and the cup. You can take it as a family, stay up here as long as you want. There's a kneeling benches, or you can go back to your seats and take it there. Whenever you're ready, come to one of the stations. Take communion, go back, and then just take it at your own time. Whenever you're ready, we're going to linger a bit, then we're going to sing another song. God, thank you for Jesus and what these moments represent, his broken body, his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. We are so grateful for this magnificent and indescribable gift that we have received. We want to enter into this new covenant. We want to continue to walk with Jesus in the new covenant, in the dispensation of grace. God, would you in these moments continue to seal us and anchor us and secure us in our walk with Christ. these sacred moments, this practice that we do. Thank you for giving your life, Jesus, willingly, sacrificially, that you could atone for the sins of humanity. You could atone for our sins so that we could be made right with God, with a holy God. Thank you. We worship you.
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spot and melt the heart of stone. Jesus made it all. To him I sin had left the crimson stain. He washed in white as snow. Before the throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin I left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin I left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
We're so grateful to God for such a great salvation. Romans 8 says, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I pray that God will launch us out of here today to remember how blessed we are to receive the good news, and that we would have gospel conversations. We'd be a light to the dark places where we will go this week. Help us to be a light for the gospel as you go. Thank you so much for being here. Just know that Kendra and I care about you. We love you. We're praying for you. the work that God is doing, our campuses in Sugar Creek and Millersburg, our vision to reach other rural communities so that no one's left behind, so every person can have this relationship with Christ. God, would you send us out with your blessing? Thank you for your goodness, for your faithfulness, for reminding us in this series that we don't have to freak out because we have a Heavenly Father who takes care of birds and flowers. You will care for us. So we rest. We have confidence. We're expectant that you have more for us. Help us to live with humility, to be a light to our neighbors, the people living down the street, in the schools, the jobs, wherever you send us this week, that we could live like we've been sent from heaven for a divine mission and for your glory. Thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, everyone.